desire to touch the people the way the Lord wants to touch them. It is God's will that none should perish, but all should have everlasting life. And that is why we're here, friends. The Bible also says that without a vision, we will perish. There's a whole world outside that is dying, who does not have a direction, or lost. And it is only possible that we equip them with the Word of God. And that is what we do. And El Shaddai equips everyone all around us in the world.
Each and every individual is being trained and taught the Word of God. Maybe the important thing is the importance is given to the Word of God and the love through the Word of God to make a maximum outreach to the people out here in the city and to be led by the spiritual father, Pastor Deepak. So nice.
Deepak's El Shaddai Ministries. Like, we have learned so much. Not only that, because I come into the home cell, which is also a wonderful way where Pastor Deepak teaches us the word, the inside meanings, where I have not got anywhere else, and which has given us such a growth of such great revelations in the Word of God. I'm just so grateful that God brought us with Pastor Deepak to know and to understand His word in a deeper way.
What is great in this world, you taking initiative to lead and to guide. And from the like you're seeing him in the mustard seed ministry that may grow into the plant and to the tree and the forest lift.
Jerusalem today, we must be sure the lamb doesn't run away. And I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the lamb. And when we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. Scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled, I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, the crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, him. Then his hand reached for his sword, and so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet upon the cross I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I've lost all sense of time, until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping, I heard the older say, Father, please forgive us. Then ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms, and we turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the
Whatever is born of God is victorious over the world. You are victorious. The world may see you different. But Good Friday is good because Jesus through the cross has made every day to be good. If you have accepted the cross, the lamb that was slain from the foundation, every day is a good day. It's not Good Friday, it's good day every day. For whatever is born of God is victorious over the world, and this is the victory. What is your victory? Your job? Not your job. What is your victory? Your friends, they leave you. What is your victory? Your family? You are victorious through your faith. What is your faith? If you have a faith, what is the faith that is victorious in the world, that overcomes the world? Verse 5. Who is it that is victorious over that conquers the world? But he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God, and who adheres, who trusts, and who relies on that fact. You remember this? What is the meaning of belief? He surrenders to it. He adheres to it. He not only surrenders to it, he trusts in it. He doesn't only trust in it, he depends completely on it. That's believing. And today I want to settle it once for all. If you have believed on the Lamb, you can believe that he is the same yesterday, he's today, and he's forever. He doesn't change. And all that you can stand on is to understand that the man whom you saw, his name was Simon. Mark 15 verse 27. Verse 21 first. And they forced a passerby. All of you are passing by in this journey towards eternity. How many of you are passing by? You're all passing by. You're all passers-by. And they forced a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and... You saw the two boys? Alexander and Rufus. Alexander, who has a name, who conquered the world, but his name is never recorded in the book of life. In scriptures, there's no mention of Alexander. But the name Rufus, who was coming in the field to carry his cross. See what happened. Verse 22. And they led him to Golgotha, in Latin, Calvary, meaning the place of the skull. Do you know why it's called the place of the skull? Because that was the skull of Goliath. when David brought the skull, the head of Goliath back, it was buried in that place. That's why it's called Golgotha. You are going to overcome your Goliath when you learn to bow down at Calvary and see the cross.
Amen.
That's the power, verse 23. And they attempted to give him wine mingled with myrrh, but he would not take it. This is speaking of Jesus. Verse 24. And they crucified him, they divided his garments and distributed them among themselves, throwing lots for them to decide who should take what. It's so, so sad. You have all these people, when the cross is going on, when crucifixion is going on, they had an opportunity for eternity. They went for earthly things. What was their perspective? Earth. If you learn to see life through earthly things, you will be seeing the cross, but you will be dividing the things, just looking for what do I get out of this. You see the difference? They were at the moment when eternity was in front of them and they could make a decision to accept the Lamb. But what did they accept? The lots. There is a lot that you can gain outside. But believe me, without the Lamb, it is empty. You can divide a lot of things. And all that I'm speaking, sometimes even churches are doing that. And I can be as vocal as that, that we need to be people who come back to our priority. Our perspective should be eternity.
Amen.
Our perspective is not earthly. I will carry the cross today because I know I'm crossing over to eternity. Nobody can give me anything to divide the lot today that I can be compromising today and not cross over to my eternity. Here you will see verse 25. And it was the third hour, about 9 o'clock in the morning, when they crucified him. Verse 26. And the inscription of the accusation against him was written about the King of the Jews. 27. And with him they crucified 2 robbers, one on his right hand and one on his left. You see another situation. You saw the sons, one Alexander, one Rufus. You can see the thief. And it's so important for us to understand that God is no respecter of any person. You can be at the same place and have different destinies. 28. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says he was counted among the transgressors. And those who passed by kept reviling him and reproaching him abusively in harsh and insolent language, wagging their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days." What were they mocking? They were mocking their own destiny. They were mocking not Christ, they were mocking their own destiny. When you compromise, you're mocking your own destiny. And I pray that you will take this Good Friday to be the day that you will turn around. If you have not accepted Christ, you will see the Lamb that was slain. God has provided the sacrifice. You don't have to go through that. At the age of 18, I went through enough to understand, God, if you are there, there was one cry. I never was looking for a Christian God. I was looking for, God, if this is the idols that I've been praying, which one of you are in? There is so much of a sacrifice that I've made, but I have not seen the redemption. And Jesus, that's why the word says, when you were yet a sinner, he came to save you. Romans 5:8. Don't turn in there. When you were yet a sinner, I was not looking for him, he was looking for me.
Amen.
That's why the beauty of the cross is not you looking for God. You can't find someone who's higher. The higher one finds you. And those who pass by, carry on, verse 30.
Now rescue yourself from the death, from death. Come down from the cross. Go in King James. Save yourself and come down from the cross. You know, this is the world perspective. Come down from your pain and you are going to be saved. Come down from all that you're going through and you will be delivered. Today, you make a choice, because Jesus understood that was necessary to cross over. If you are in the Lord, all that you're going through has been allowed by His loving hands. He loves you and He holds you. Not to break you, but to build you up. And all that He's working is to cleanse you. He will cleanse you, He will cover you, and then He will make you to cross over on the other side. He's not there to expose you, He's bringing it to cover you. Isaac, you listen. He's out there to cover you. Allow Him to cleanse you. What is He asking you today to take it out of your life? Some of the things you are bringing, the baggages, when they pass over, they cannot bring anything that was of the old into the new. That's why the sacrifice was needed. And here, the perspective was, those that were passing by said, just come down and save yourself. You know, till today, people tell, take the easy way out. Do you have to follow the word? You don't have to follow the word. You can be in the world and still follow the Lamb. That's not the way. Save yourself. If you save yourself, he that saves his life will lose it. Learn to see, this is the principle, this is the way people look at things. What do I get when I follow Christ? Yes, there is a cross, but I will cross over on the other side. And if I carry this cross, verse 31, world religion sometimes can't understand why your Savior is at the cross. He can't save himself. How can he save you? You know, these scribes, that's why the people of the law, of their faith, they can't understand, because the wisdom of God is far greater than the wisdom of any man. The Bible says the foolishness of God is greater, and the cross looks foolish, but it is the power and the wisdom of God unto salvation. Likewise also the chief priests mocking said among themselves with the scribes, he save others, himself he cannot save. Verse 32, let Christ the King of Israel descend now. I want you to remember this very simple lines. Without the cross, you can't cross over. Without the cross, it's only over. This is another line I want you to remember. If you descend, you will not ascend. Let Christ the King descend now. If you lower your standard from the word and allow compromise, you will not see the promotion that God has for you. Sometimes it's so straightforward. That's why the way is narrow. Broad is the way to damnation. The way to salvation is narrow. If you descend, what did they say? Let Christ the King descend now. If he had descended, there would have been no salvation for anyone. If you descend now, there is going to be no salvation, no deliverance for your generations. That's why do not only carry the cross, I'm asking you from today, celebrate the cross. Not only celebrate Christ, celebrate what you go through. God will not allow anything that comes into your life without Him having a purpose for it. Everybody never understood why He had to carry the cross. In the mind of God, there was already, He saw you, He saw everyone, and He said, this is necessary. You know why you're going through what you're going through? When you celebrate the cross, you are easier going to cross over on the other side. I want you to remember this. Luke 23, 29, 39. One of the victims. And one of the thieves which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. It's so sad. The passerby said, come down, save yourself. He had the opportunity. He was by the side at the cross. He was going through his own pain. Sometimes God allows certain things for us to reach out to Him. This was one place that this man missed. He was so close and yet so far. Every one of us who is in Christ is so close, yet sometimes you can be so far. Because if your perspective is not able to see what Christ has done at the cross, you are always going to see how to save yourself. What was he saying? And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, if thou be Christ, save thyself and us. One of the Satan's strategy today among believers is, if you are in Christ, why are you going through this? If you are a believer, you should be rich. If you are a believer, you should always be healthy. If you follow Christ, you will always see. And where is it? This is exactly a strategy that Satan always uses. That 40. But the other answering rebuked him. Exactly two. Saying, dost thou not fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? What makes us to see the cross? The fear of God. When we have the fear of God, we learn to allow the cross to have its work in us. What was he saying? Verse 41. We indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing amiss. What was he saying? He was saying, I'm a sinner. I have not seen anyone except Christ. Unless they have understood there is something missing in their life. That's why the beauty of the cross is, if you are humble enough, if you can see how bad you are, God has already an answer. If you think you made it, that's why the New Age books is to bring you up to that level, to start thinking there is something good inside of you. And you can always reach in your own strength. I pray that you will always remember, in our own flesh, there is nothing good. If there is anything good in me, it's because of Christ. Always remember this. You can always see the power of the cross. Verse 42. a difference. This is the fastest crossover that I think in eternity. God, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. When can you get saved? The day you say, Lord, I'm willing, I'm a sinner, I've not done in my own self anything good, but remember me. And see that verse 43. And Jesus said unto him, truly I say unto you, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. What was his act? The same what the other thief did on the was on the cross. But his act was, he acknowledged it. He acknowledged that there was nothing good in him. He acknowledged that I need a Savior. He acknowledged that today I want you to come into my life. And that completely changed the whole thing. The day you have accepted, acknowledged, you will see the cross working. The Savior saves. Luke 17 verse 20. And when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God comes not with observation. This is one of the most important scripture. If today you are a believer, where is the kingdom of God? If you come across anyone, Aisha is speaking to you, you are placed there for a purpose. Jesus is in you. It's not by observation. People are looking, where is? Verse 21. Neither shall they say, lo here or there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. You have the anointing of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When the Holy Spirit comes in you, when Jesus comes into you, you can't accept Jesus until the Holy Spirit has made it, has convicted you. He has brought that change inside of you. And if he has begun the good work, he will bring it to completion. That's why don't go looking out for the answers. God has the answers inside of you. And start activating. Say, Holy Spirit, I'm willing. Where do I start? What do I do? Verse 31. In that day, which is that day? The day when the lamb was slain, Alexander and Rufus. The day when the thieves were by the side. When is that day? On a Good Friday today. When is that day? It's every day.
Amen.
In that day, he which shall be upon the housetop and his stuff in the house, let him not come down to take it away. Why is it written like this? You know, there's been a question time and again asked, will all believers be raptured? You know, the answer is here. The day the stuff becomes more important than the spirit that is inside of you, you will be left behind. If the Spirit of God is leading you, Romans 8:14, they that are led by the Spirit of God, at the time of the rapture, you're not going back for the stuff. You are ready. That's why make sure you glance at things, you gaze at God.
Amen. Amen.
You know what is happening today? People are gazing at things and glancing at God. You know what is a glance? If you've been married, you'll understand what is gazing. You're supposed to gaze to the one you're married. You know, now it's the other way around. You glance to the one that you're married. You gaze outside. And I pray this is going to be different. If you are gazing to what God wants you to be seeing at the time of the rapture, you are going to make it. Stuff should never take the priority above your spirit. The kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of God is not in things. Things are going to be following you. You are going to follow the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let him not come down to take it away. Verse 32. How beautiful this word is. Remember? Lot's wife. What was the problem with Lot's wife? She had so much of her life and her stuff that she was not ready to surrender. If you have today anything, your stuff, that you can't surrender, remember Lot's wife. Because if you have not put it at the cross, this is nothing compared to what you are. Everything, verse 33, whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it. Whosoever shall lose his life, what is he saying? If you are willing to surrender your life to Christ, you will gain it. If you are not willing to give him the life, there is no sacrifice. There is no sacrifice anyone can make that can redeem you. Verse 34. I tell you, in that night there shall be two in one bed. The one shall be taken, the other shall be left. Well, what am I saying to you? You can never say, I was not saved because somebody made me do this. You are responsible for yourself. You can be in the same place. You can be taken, somebody else left. You will be the Rufus. They may be the Alexander. Verse 35. Two women shall be grinding together, the one shall be taken, the other left. It's so important for us to remember, God is going to fulfill this word. 36. Two men shall be in the field. Field is, the Bible says, the field is the world. The one shall be taken, the other shall be left. It's very clear. Romans 16:13. This is Rufus. You want to see the name Rufus? The same boy you saw there. Romans 16:13. Am I saying to you? The Lord salutes you. Why he salutes you? Because when you have chosen him, has he not chosen everyone? Has he died for the whole world?
Yes.
Thank you. He's died for the whole world, whether you call it Indians, every other person. He has died for every one of the, for God so loved the
world.
Salute Rufus. You were there, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and
mine.
As for me and my house, we are going to be saved. Do you get what I'm saying? Today, when I was at the age of 13, 18, my brother was, I got one brother, 16, two sisters, at that time they were 14, and 12. They had no understanding of what they were making a choice. Today you can be the person in your family that makes all the difference. My brother is saved and married in Jakarta. Son's name is James. Daughter's name is Christina. Christina. Well, my brother's daughter. Sometimes God speaks, he brings one Christina back. Well, my brother reminds you. My one sister, they all come to the Lord. My one sister is in the US. At the age of 18, every one of us was at the pit. Through the cross, through the blood, every one of us had received the power of God. How did we receive that? At the age of 18, when I accepted, nobody saluted me. That word, salute. But remember this, when God salutes you, everybody starts saluting you. If you have chosen Him, He has chosen you. And if He has chosen you, celebrate the cross. Celebrate the cross. What am I saying, celebrate the cross? I'm not speaking about. What is the cross in your life? Did you see the man was forced to carry the cross? Was that him carrying the cross of Jesus or Jesus carrying his cross?
Jesus.
Thank you. The sin for which you have been to pay the price of the cross, He has carried it. For that small moment, like Simon, maybe you will have to take it. That's why in that small moment, do not allow your complaint, your cry, to miss seeing what God wants to do. You know how Paul sees it? 2 Corinthians 4:17. You know Paul went through what? The way he was 39 times striped, he was beaten, the thieves caught him. There were so many things he's gone through. But what is his definition? The cross is our light affliction, which is but for a whatever you're going through. He has carried the cross, the sin that was upon you, he has paid it at the cross. If you have to carry for that small moment, it is a, remember this, it's a privilege. I would not have understood what Christ can do if I had not received the cross at the age of 18. I would not have crossed over today. The cross you are facing today is only to make you to cross over. And make sure you don't cut short your crosses. I don't know if anybody remembers, there was a clipping I showed you.
Yes.
There's a person that was carrying the cross. He said, Lord, it's too heavy. Can I cut it short? Cuts it short, goes a little further, and says, Lord, little more. Cuts it more, until he comes to the place where everybody that was carrying the cross knew there was a purpose that cross was to be laid, because to the other side there was
a ditch.
And the moment they all laid that cross, they could cross over. This man who was cutting it short every time, he came short of crossing over. Every experience that you have is purposed by a loving hand. Simon, why is it Good Friday? Simon must have said, if only I had gone another way, I would have saved myself from picking up the cross and my two tender children to see something like this. If only some other day I had gone, I would have missed carrying the cross. I would have been saved of this sight, because that was the day. If only I'd taken a different route, if only I'd chosen a different day. What Simon didn't know was that God was at work. It was not him, it was God choosing him to go through that path. It was God making him to go on that day. And because of that day, it was the worst day of his life. It became the best day for eternity. What am I saying to you? When you surrender to him, your worst day is programmed by him to be the best day. In eternity, Simon must be sitting up and thinking, if it was not for that day, I would not be sitting in heaven. Rufus, if it was not for that path my fathers took, I would not be making the choices of following the cross. Everything that is allowed in your life has been purposed so that it will build you up, not break you down. As we're going to partake in communion, Abraham had to give a sacrifice. But there was already a sacrifice that was provided. What is the sacrifice that God is asking you to make? You seem to be so lost thinking about the sacrifice. But turn around. Behold the Lamb. Jehovah Jireh.
One I love the most.
As a sign of your faith.
Oh, this must be the hardest hill I've ever climbed. For I must sacrifice you, promised son of mine. And so I go to worship with you by my side. and trust a sacrifice He will provide. And though I cherish you, I must now offer you to Him who is the giver of all good things. And though I cherish you, I will now offer you, for surely He could raise you up again. Altar, Father, I lay all my dreams and offer back to you this child you've given me. Oh, Son, you must believe He's called us to obey, and by His love you'll make a better way. And though I cherish you, I must now offer you to Him who is the giver of all good things. And though I cherish you, I will now offer you, for surely He will raise you up again. Oh Abraham, oh Abraham, now that I know you fear my name, withhold your hand. Your only Son, He's not the one. Behold the Ram, behold the Lamb. It must have been the hardest thing He'd ever done, when God the Father sacrificed His only Son, the one that He most cherished gave His life away, and by His love He made a better way. And so I cherish you, so I honor you, for truly you're the giver of all good things. And so I cherish you, and so I honor you. Your sacrifice is now the King of Kings, Jehovah Jireh. He has provided the sacrifice of love no man could ever pay, and what He